chair, as a former workshop manager, I'm now as your keynote speaker this year. As you heard, I'm a professor of astronomy and astrophysics at UC Santa Cruz. That means that I'm a research scientist, so I spend a lot of my time learning new things about the universe, doing science. And then I spend another lot of my time teaching other people, so teaching college students in their classes, and also training graduate students to be the next generation of research scientists. So what I think I'm going to do today is I'm going to tell you a little bit about the science work that I do, why I'm so excited about it, and then I'll tell you a little bit about my path as how I got there from where you are today. All right, so I'm an astrophysicist, and my area of specialty is extrasolar planets. So extrasolar means around stars other than the sun. So our sun's name is Sol, or at least it's one of the names of Sol. And so extrasolar means around a star other than the sun. So our planets all go around the sun. And I'm interested in planets around other stars. And why am I interested in this? I'm interested in it because I really want to know, is Earth rare? So I'm sorry, my slides are cut off at the bottom, but it'll be okay, I'll just say what they say. Is our planet unusual in the universe? Are we unusual? Are there planets out there with life on them, like ours somewhere? And if so, can we find them? And you know, not so long ago, this was a question that was really just in the realm of science fiction. You know, when I was your age, we hadn't found any planets around the stars other than the sun. We only knew about our solar system. And just in the past 20 years, that has really changed. We now know that if you point at any star in the sky, it has planets orbiting around it, just like ours, and some of them might be like Earth. So now that's the question that we want to answer. Are they like Earth, or are they not like Earth? And might there be life on them? So what I do when I try to answer this question is I try to ask a little bit different question, which is related, and that is the solar system rare? So here I have a diagram of our solar system. There's the sun at the center, Earth, Mercury, Venus, Mars. And then there's the asteroid belt, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Out of the very outer edge is the Kuiper belt. The Kuiper belt is the reason that Pluto is no longer a planet. I like to say we didn't lose a planet, we gained a belt. The Kuiper belt is actually really awesome, but I'm not going to talk about it today. And on this diagram, the planets are not to scale. I've made them much bigger than they really are compared to each other. But the orbits are to scale. So we have the planets, the Earth, Mercury, Venus, and Mars in the middle. And then we have giant planets in the outside of the system. And the reason that I'm interested in asking, is the solar system rare, is that it's actually still a lot easier for us to see some of the other planets in our solar system if they were around another star than it is to see the Earth. So if we look around other systems and we can see planets like Jupiter or Saturn, then maybe we might think that those systems are like ours and maybe they might have an Earth-type system. So let me say a little bit more about what these planets are like. Here's Earth, and here's Mars. And the atmospheres of Earth and Mars, we call these rocky planets, are really tiny, only about a millionth of the mass on Earth. So, right, so your mass, if you're on Earth, tells you how much you weigh. Out in space, you don't have any scales, so we just talk about mass. A millionth of this of the stuff on Earth is in its atmosphere. So this is obviously really crucial for us, right, because we need to breathe. But it's a very tiny amount of the planet. The same is true for Mars, it's even less. And you can see it in these pictures, the sort of diffuse little sort of edge around the outside of the planet. But if you go out to Jupiter, out farther in our system, then you see something that's really different. Jupiter is actually more than 95% hydrogen and helium gas. So it doesn't have this tiny little atmosphere, the whole thing is basically atmosphere. And actually, if you put Earth and Mars next to Jupiter, now these are sized to scale, you can see that it's much bigger. And if you look at Jupiter, it actually has four moons around it that look kind of like rocky planets themselves. So in a way, Jupiter is almost like a star with its own planetary system around it. And here's one of those moons, it's called Ganymede, right next to Mars. And these are to scale, and you can see they're very similar sorts of things. So Jupiter is a planet, it goes around the sun, but it has its own, we call them moons, but they're very much like our rocky planets going around it. So it's a very different thing from the Earth. Now that Uranus and Neptune, giant planets as well. They are giant, but they're not quite as giant as Jupiter and Saturn. Professional astronomers call them ice giants, and they're sort of in between. So Jupiter's about 300 times the mass of the Earth, Uranus and Neptune are about 17 times the mass of the Earth. So they're sort of in between, and they have in-between sorts of atmospheres as well. All right, so now we can go back and look at this diagram of the solar system. Now I have in here four Earths, two Jupiters, and two Neptunes. And I'm kind of joking when I draw it this way, because I'm just saying there are three kinds of planets, Earths, Jupiter, and Neptune. But when we look around other stars, this is basically what we can tell so far about the planets around them. We can tell if they're little like Earth, if they're giant like Jupiter, or if they're in between like Neptune. And what we're trying to do next is to figure out more about them, like what are they actually really like. But this is what we can tell so far. So now if we want to say our systems around other stars like ours, we want to know, do you have rocky planets in the middle, and then Jupiters, and then Neptunes on the outside? And if we want to figure that out, so I'm a theorist. I do physics and math all day. And the way I try to figure this out is I try to think about how do you make these systems? And this is a picture of where they're made. This is called the Orion star forming region. And here you see in these little insets, little baby stars that are being formed. And around each star, you've got this sort of fuzzy bit, and that is a disk of gas and dust. And now I've made a diagram of it. Here's your baby star that's forming. You have this disk of gas, dust, and ice that's falling onto the star. It's trying to get from the cloud where the star is forming onto the star. But some of it gets left over. And in that leftover bit, you end up with debris, sort of leftover trash, and that's what the planets are. So we're just the debris that's left over from star formation. And within that gas and dust, we can say, well, if you're in the middle, maybe there's not so much material to make stuff out of, so you make tiny things like the rocky planets. And then as you go out farther, you start having more stuff. You can just see that the area of the disk is larger, so it gets more complicated than this, of course. But just basically, there's more material, and so you can make larger things that can accrete a lot of that gas that's around any of your gas giant planets. All right. Okay, so that was our idea about how you make a planetary system before we got exoplanets, so planets around other stars. And it sounds great, and it is great. But then we went out and looked over the past 20 years, and we found all of these systems around other stars. And it turns out that they're nothing like what we expected. So I'm just going to really briefly tell you a couple of ways that we can see planets. So here's a picture of a planet going around a star. These are not the right size. The star is obviously much bigger than the planet. But when a planet's going around a star, it makes the star go around a little bit too. And we can actually do it one more time. And we can watch the star moving around because quantum mechanics tells us that certain atoms in the star make these lines in the spectrum. So when you take the light from the star, we spread it out like with a prism. You've probably done that. And when we do that for a star, it has lines in it because of quantum mechanics. So at some point, we'll learn why that's true. And they go back and forth because the star's moving around, and we can see that that's because there's a planet there. And what we found, this is a plot. I'll just show a couple plots, just for the sake of showing plots. I'm a scientist, I like to show plots. So here's the distance from the star. And this is how circular the orbit is. So these are really circular planets. And these are planets that have really, really oval orbits around their stars. And here are our planets. These red ones are giant planets that we can see this way. And you can see that all these dots show that planets around other stars are just not nearly as circular as ours. And if you think about it, this has a big implication. Because if our Earth went really close to the sun and then came really far away, we'd be toasted once a year and then frozen once a year. It wouldn't be a good place for us to live. So a lot of these planets are not looking good for being.
We need a place to stay. So when you look out close to the sun, you go to the
farthest
side
you possible. So that's a great idea. You said if you get close to the sun, you go to the farthest part of the planet. And then if you get far from the sun, you go to the closest part of the planet. But the planet is actually really small compared to the difference in distance from the sun for a lot of these planets. So even if you went to when it was really close to the sun, the farthest side of the planet would still be too hot. Yeah, So every time this planet comes in front of the star, it just makes the star dim a little bit. And we found a lot of planets that way, too. And here's my second plot. This is also just distance from the star and the size of the planet. And what I want you to take away from this is here's Earth and Neptune. And there are a ton of stars that have planets that are in between Earth and Neptune in size. So we've got nothing like this in our solar system. No planets at all. And it turns out that about a third of the stars in the sky have planets like this that just don't look anything like the solar system at all. So it's super weird. Our system apparently isn't the way all planetary systems look. So I said, is the solar system rare? And we already know that the answer is the solar system's not typical. There are lots of systems not like ours. But it still could be common. There could still be a lot of systems like ours out there. And that's what we're trying to figure out. So that's what I'm working on. And I'm a theorist, so I work on all these pieces. How do you make that disk that you form your planets out of? How do you form planets in it? How do they move around after they form? And how do you make their atmospheres? And can we figure out what makes the different kinds of systems that we look at? And really what I want to know is then can we go find some that might have life on them like ours? And I think that would just be a really amazing thing for us as people to learn. Which give us a really good sense of whether we are or aren't alone in the universe. So that's the science that I do. I think I'll spend the rest of my time just talking a little bit about how I started doing this. Here's a picture of, this is from 9 years ago. This is my daughter, she's nine now. She was born the day I graduated with my PhD. So I didn't get to go to my graduation ceremony. I wish she had waited one more day. Kids tell you, you know, they make it very clear who's the most important person very early on. So I have two kids, they're 9 and 5, I'm married. I just want you to know that, you know, you can be a research scientist and have kids and have a family. I'm from Southern California, I'm from Irvine, which is where I grew up. And from there, I went to Harvard and to Berkeley for school. I just want to tell you some things that I did when I was your age that I think really served me well over time. And my slides are just going to be some cliche words that you've probably heard before, but I think they're worth saying more than once because they're important. Okay. So the first one is that I learned that you should always keep learning and reinventing yourself. And actually, one of the reasons that I love being a scientist is because it lets you just keep learning about the world and about the universe just throughout your whole life. But this is true, for no matter what you want to do. And I'm going to digress for a moment, and then I'll make it clear why this is about science in a moment. So when I was in elementary school and junior high, I was a gymnast. I don't have the right body type to be a gymnast. But I was really serious about it. And I worked on it really hard, and I got really incredibly good at it. And I thought that this was something that was just a really important lesson in my life. I mean, you know this, the people who are successful are not the people who come in and get something right away, necessarily. I mean, that can make it a little bit easier, but that's not what makes you successful at something. What makes you successful at something is sticking with it and working hard on it. So, you know, when I was in junior high, math was not the hardest thing for me. But it was not the thing that I was most proud of either. What I was most proud of was being a gymnast, because it was really hard for me, and I was really good at it anyway, because I worked on it so hard. When I was in high school, I decided I wanted to be in the marching band, and I didn't play a marching band instrument, so I decided I was going to learn the saxophone over the summer, because that's what I wanted to do, was be in a marching band. So I did. I learned the saxophone over the summer, and I worked hard on it, and eventually I became the section leader in my band. So my point here, now to come back, why is this about science? I feel like a lot of times we're told, you know, just in our culture, in our country, but especially for us as girls and women, that, oh, maybe you're just not a science person, or maybe you're just not a math person. That's okay, you can do other things. But, you know, that's just, that's not right. You know, all of you can be a science or a math person. It doesn't matter whether it's the easiest thing for you. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. What will make you successful at science and math is working on it. And you know, math and science are also, they're hard for everyone. It's just a matter of when it gets hard. So if it's not hard for you yet, maybe you need to find some more challenging stuff to do. And I'm just going to say it again because it really bothers me when people say, oh no, I don't have to learn how to do math. It's just not my thing. It's a skill. It's a skill. If you work hard on it, you get better at it. And then it'll be something that you can use. And I learned that in my life from gymnastics, and maybe you have that experience in some of your sports teams or music or something like that as well. Okay. Another thing is, you know, you want to prepare yourself for opportunities. I had no idea when I was your age that astronomy was something that I could do as a career, that I could actually get paid for what I'm doing right now. I mean, it's pretty amazing that that I get to do this for my life. There are a lot of things out there that you can do, and you don't necessarily know what they all are yet, and it's just really worth putting in the effort now to be prepared for the opportunities that you want to have. And there are a lot of things that you can do as a scientist to improve the world. Maybe you're interested in trying to help save our environment. Maybe you're interested in developing technology. Maybe you're interested in bringing solutions back to your community for problems your community has. Science can get you a lot of different places. And if you, you know, embrace its fullness now and put in the work and effort to get there, then it'll really be something that's in your tool belt in the future. And this comes back again to sometimes we're told, I think, as women and girls, that we are not science or math people. That's a way of taking away your power to do what you want to do in your life. So don't let people do that to you. You know, keep your power and, you know, working on what you want to do. Okay, I'm just going to say this briefly, though I know it's pretty far in the future, but college, so I went to college after high school. College is a place where you learn what's known. In science, that means you learn the science that people have already understood. And then I went to graduate school. And graduate school is a place where you can learn how to discover new knowledge. So I trained graduate students to be the next generation of researchers. And one of the reasons I just want to mention this is that in science, you get paid to go to graduate school. So sometimes people will say, if you want to be a scientist, you have to be in school forever. And I guess it's sort of true. I was in school until I was 29. But most of that graduate school, it was a job. It wasn't just like being a high school student forever. So you can get paid. There are always challenges. I'll just mention one challenge because it's been in the news recently, which is that there have been some high-profile cases of sexual harassment in our field. And, you know, that's something that I've had to deal with over time. And that's something that I think many people in many fields have to deal with over time. But we are in a moment where there are a lot of people who are really pushing for change. And a lot of people who are willing to support change. So I was able, there was a professor who was a graduate student who was harassing women in the department. And it took years and years, but eventually we were able to get him disciplined. And he's no longer an astronomer. So, you know, I think that there are many challenges that we face in our lives. Many, and you know, they're different for different people. I've had privileges that I understand. I didn't have to work when I was in college. Well, I did work, but I didn't work when I was in high school. And you know, we don't always all have that privilege. I also had very supportive parents. You know, it's worth reflecting on, you know, the benefits that you have and the challenges that you face and the things that you don't necessarily have. There are a lot of people out there who are willing to help you with if you can find them. So, you know, people here in this group, I'm sure, are excited about helping you find resources to support you. And I would be happy to do that to you if you'd like to come. So with that, I'll just end with, I am so excited to be a scientist. It's the most awesome career that you can possibly have, because you can go out, define your own questions that you're excited about the universe, define your own job to answer them, and answer them.
Wow, right? for being here and sharing your story with us and sharing some inspiring words. So one takeaway that I heard was, it's not necessarily something you're good at, but it's something that you're determined to be good at, right? So I want to see if there's someone in the audience who doesn't mind sharing. Could you share something that you really had to work hard at or you're really proud of? And it could be something that someone told you, oh, you don't look like an athlete, or you don't look like a scientist, or you don't look like someone who would be into math. But does someone you feel comfortable sharing something that they're really good at and they're happy to be good at? Can you tell me your name too?
My name is Callie. Hi. Well, someone told me that when I first auditioned for one play, it was so funny because I couldn't barely could sing. And I just kept working at it, and someone was like, oh, really like this. And then I kept working at it. And now I'm one of the most prestigious all the choirs in my school.
That's awesome! From the essence stem to sing, I like it. One more person, sure. Phoebe? That is a really cool talent.
It actually was sort of easy for me. There was this thing that you hold up to a mirror and I could read it.
Super cool, hidden talents, right? So one more phrase that you used was keep your power. So I just want, before I break you out, to just repeat that with me a couple of times. Is that okay? It's keep your power, right? So you can say keep my power, keep your power, right? And we're just gonna kind of chant it to let that sink in. Because it's super important. You will face challenges. You will have people tearing you down. But you can find champions and mentors and advisors like Dr. Ruth, right? So let's try that, okay?
Keep your power.
Keep your power.
One more time. Keep your power.